We're going to learn from the Zera Shimshon. Last week I gave a little bit of a background about the Zera Shimshon. And we're going to learn from Parashat Shlach Lecha, which the theme of the parasha, of course, is the sin of the spies. And Moshe sends spies into Eretz Israel, and they come back. There's a very big argument what exactly was going on there, because we know most commentaries say they spoke Lashon Hara, but Eretz Israel. Nevertheless, comes a big question that says, but wait a minute, they were saying the truth. They were saying that everything that they saw was the truth. So first of all, Lashon Hara is the truth. It's just saying it in a way that nobody benefits from it. Besides the point that what they did is they gave their own commentary. And nobody asked them if to give commentary or not. They were just sent to find the information and then come back. And nobody was expecting them, or they didn't need to add on that anything. But nevertheless, we find that from the 12 spies that were sent, two of them were good. Yoshua ben Nun, who was the servant of Moshe Rabbeinu, and Kalev ben Yefuneh. And for whatever reason, they were the ones who were chosen to not to sin with the spies. And we're going to learn from a verse from the Torah that Moshe Rabbeinu changed Yeshua's name. On Shabbat, I don't know if you were here, but I was talking about it, that it says in this parasha, Vayikra Moshe leHoshea ben Nun Yehoshua, and Moshe called Yehoshua Hoshea ben Nun Yehoshua. How can it be? This is not what we're going to talk about today, but I was addressing it on Shabbat. How can it be that now the Torah says that Moshe called Hoshea ben Nun Yehoshua, when we find many times in previous parashot that his name was already Yehoshua? I mean, we find that so many times. But nevertheless, the answer is that even then his name was Hoshea, but the Torah is referring to him as Yehoshua for the future when his name is going to be changed. But nevertheless, let's read from the Zera Shimshon and we'll see what he says here, because we're going on the weeks, on the verse that it says, Vayikra Moshe leHoshea ben Nun Yehoshua. Moshe called Hoshea ben Nun Yehoshua. This can be found in the Parashat Bamidbar in chapter 13, verse 16. Rashi explains, Rashi is a commentator, he explains, Yudke means Hashem, Yoshiacha me'atzat meraglim. Hashem is going to save you from the bad advice that the spies gave. Now comes a big question. Why is it saying Yudke will save you? Lama Yudke Yoshiacha v'lo afilu ot achat min Hashem yechol gam ken. First of all, what Yudke? Yudke means the letter Yud and the letter Hey. That comes from the name of Hashem, Yudke Vavke. First of all, and most important, why half the name of Yudke Vavke? Why only Yud and the Hey? Comes a different question that the Zera Shimshon is asking. Why Yud and the Hey? Isn't Yud enough? Why you need two letters? More than that, Afilu ot achat min Hashem yachol gam yachol. Even one letter from Hashem's name is enough. If Moshe already wants to give Yoshua a letter to protect him, then just give the Yud. Why you need two letters, Yud and a Hey? First of all, as a side note, this is one of the places in the Torah. We find many places in the Torah, but this is one of the places in the Torah that we see that changing the name by adding a letter makes a huge difference in the person's blessing and the person's protection, health, parnasa, the livelihood, and so forth. We find that with Sarah, that her name was Sarai. Here the letter was switched from a Yud to a Hey. With Abraham, we find that his name was Avram, then they added a Hey, Abraham. So here is another name that we find, that a letter was added, suddenly it's a whole different thing. But nevertheless, the Zera Shimshon is asking, why did you need two letters to save Yoshua? Isn't one letter enough? Why Yudke? Should have been one letter. Not in that. Gam ken lehoshia matzat meraglim. So one letter to add to Yoshua's name could be enough to save from the sin of the spies. Not only that, ve'od shelefi ha'emet lo osif lo ela yud. But really, when we're looking at it, Moshe didn't add two letters, Yud and a Hey. He added only a Yud, because his name was already Hoshea. So he just really added a yud and it became Yehoshua. More than that, ve'od ma tzorech l'shtei dvarim. Why did Moshe Rabbeinu need two actions? One action is to add the letters to the name, and the other action that Moshe Rabbeinu prayed for him. He says, Hosafat ha'ot shel Hashem ve'gam itpaler lav. Ve'aloch b'chad ha'minai usagi. One action is enough. So we have here a few questions. First question is, how come then Moshe Rabbeinu added the letters to Yoshua's name? First of all. And why does it say specifically the Yud and the Hey and not one letter is enough? Or could it be any letter? So this is the first question. The second question, why did Moshe Rabbeinu need to do two actions, the adding the letters and the praying, in order to save Yehoshua? Okay, this is the question that the Zera Shimshon is asking. And in order to understand that, is referring us to the Zohar, to read a certain portion of what the Zohar says in order to understand what he wants to teach us. And this is, of course, Zohar from Parashat Tzrach. And it says as follows, Vayishlach otam Moshe. Moshe sent the spies from the desert of Paran. And again, this is now quoting the Zohar. We're reading from the Zera Shimshon, but we're quoting the Zohar, what we're reading right now. And it says as follows, Kulam anashim. They were all heads of the nation of Israel. Kulhu zakain havu. They were all righteous, and not only that, they were all heads of all the tribes of Israel. So when Moshe Rabbeinu sent the spies, they were not sinners. They were actually, first of all, they were all tzaddikim, but more than that, they were each one a head of each tribe. But, aval, inun dibru legarmayu eta bisha. But nevertheless, even being righteous, they still plotted with each other, hey, let's change a little bit what we see here. And they took on themselves a bad, what's called etzara'a, made a bad advice. And they using the word, the Zohar uses the word legarmaihu, to them, to themselves, why? Here is the secret, what was wrong with the spies. Now, we go back to a different source, to the scripts of the Ari HaKadosh, Rabbi Yitzchak Luria, and he says there's something very interesting. Ma katav HaRizal, shekasher nityatzu lehara. The HaRizal says that every one of these spies, they went into Eretz Israel, each one was presenting one tribe. The second that they went into Eretz Israel, the soul of each one of the tribes got incarnated in them, got what's called impregnant in them. So the person who was presenting the Shevet of Shimon, then the soul of Shimon was impregnant in him. The person who was representing the tribe of God, then the soul of God went in them. This is what the Arizal says. But the second that they went into Eretz Israel and they were plotting with each other, let's change the information, let's do something wrong. Miyad parchu mehem nishmot ha-shvatim. Right away, the souls of the shvatim, of the tribes, left them and they were stayed by themselves. Now we continue. Amai natlei etada. What was the benefit when they decided to do this plot, to say, to talk bad about the land of Israel? What was the benefit here? Ela amru, what did they say? What's going to happen if the nation of Israel is going to walk into the land of Israel? You know what's going to happen? We're going to be fired from our jobs. Up until now, we are each and every one of us a president of a tribe. Nesi Rosh Bnei Israel. This is the right way is called the prince, the head of the tribe. In our generation, they will be called the president, the head. They knew that if they walk into Eretz Israel, that's it. They're going to be switched. They're going to lose their status. Why? Ki anachnu mibchinat le'a hanikret dor ha-midbar. At the time of the desert, it was a different level, and they were called the level of Le'a. But nevertheless, if they walk into Eretz Israel, then it changes the status. Ve'yimnei Moshe Reishin acharani. Now Moshe is going to come. We will be fired. We're going to lose our status. And Moshe Rabbeinu will appoint other people. Deha anan zachenan b'madbara lemehve reishin. But now when we're in the desert, we merit to be the heads of the tribes. Aval be'ara lo nizke. But once we go into Eretz Israel, we lose our status. Ve'al denat le'et abisha legarmayo. And that's why they took on themselves this bad advice to, hey, let's say the land is bad. We don't have to go into Eretz Israel. Now we keep our status. We'll stay presidents here. But what was the result? Mitu inun v'chol inun denatlan milayu. All of them died. And all the ones who listened to them also died. So we learn here two things. First of all, they spoke Lashon Hara. What was the result? They died. Who else died? The one who spoke, the one who listened to the Lashon Hara, and the one who accepted the Lashon Hara. That in itself is a lesson, what Lashon Hara means, how severe it is, even if it's the truth. Even if they said the truth, but they manipulated it. They said it in a way that wasn't supposed to be said. Nevertheless, they died, and everybody who listened to it died. But what really do we learn from that? That they cared about their status. They said, if we're going to go into the land of Israel, the status will be changed, will be fired. We're not going to be the heads of the tribes anymore. Moshe Rabbeinu will fire us and will give the job to somebody else. That's what the Zohar says. Okay, now let's go back to the Zerah Shimshon. And the Zerah Shimshon is quoting the Zohar. Now it says as follows, V'katvu ha-mekubalim. The sages of Kabbalah have written, and this is specifically referring to the Arizal, and it can be found in the gate that is called Shah Ruach HaKodesh. This is one of the scripts of the Arizal, specifically in Tikkun Zayin. It says over there, Sheshem Yud Kei Eino Shore Al Baalei Geava. Oy, oy, oy. The name of Hashem Yud Kei cannot dwell on a person that has pride. What's called a Baal Geava. Why? The word Geava, Gimel, Hey, Vav, and Hey, this means pride. This is ego. This is the ego in our generation, or in any generation, but ego, Geava, the numerical value of Geava is 15. Gimel is 3, Aleph is 1, Vav is 6, and Hey is 5, which is equal to the name Yud and Hey. Yud and Hey is 15 too. So what is the Arizal says? That the name Yudkei cannot dwell, the Shekhinah cannot dwell on a person that has an ego, that has some type of a yeshut, what's called a geava. Vehovil v'she'elu anashim chatu michamat ha-geava. What was their sin, the Zohar says? Geava. I want to be the president. Ego. I don't want somebody else to be. I want to be the head. I want to be the top notch. Since they had geava, then the name of Yudkei was removed from them. And what was the geava? Shenityaru she'avirum hem ha'gdula liot rashem. They were afraid that they would lose their status. That was their ego. And since they had the ego, that was the sin. So the name Yudkei Vavkei could not dwell on them. That's what the Arizal explains in Sar Ruach HaKodesh. Okay, so now we understand why specifically the name Yudkei was added to Yoshua, and also what was their problem. Now we can understand another thing. Mishum hachi, from there we can understand lirmoz al ze hosif ot achat mashem venitzarfa im ot harishona shel Hoshea shiot hei. But we see that the name Yudkei was added to Yoshua. Really, it wasn't really added because he already had the hei. Moshe only added to him the yud, and he said ve'amar Yudkei Yoshiacha. The name Yud and then Hey will be your salvation, your help, your protection from the Atzat HaMeraglim, from what they decided to do. Meaning, Klomar, Ra'ui hu she'Hashem Yeshuacha lefi she'haya anav. Why would the name of Hashem, Yudkei, protect Yoshua? Moshe also prayed for him. Isn't the prayer enough? Maybe Hashem, maybe Moshe Rabbeinu could say, I'm giving you a Yud. You already have the hay, right? Because your name is Hoshea. So really, when you're looking at the text, he only gave him a yud. But specifically, he said yud K. Why? Because the name of Hashem will be your protection, your salvation. Why? But why would yud K will help him? You know why? לפי שהיה ענב. Only because Yeshua was humble. He had מידת הענבה. If he would not have מידת הענבה, the name Yud-K would not help him. This is what he's saying. This is the חידוש. כדי שלא יחטא כמוהם, because he was humble, and Moshe Rabbeinu now said, now I'm going to bless you that the name Yud-K will be upon you, so you're not going to sin like them. Now we understand why he prayed for him. וזו אינה תפילה ממש, this is not a real prayer that Moshe did, אלא שנראית כמו תפילה, it sounds like a תפילה, it sounds and it looks like Moshe Rabbeinu prayed for Yoshua, ובאמת אינה, and really it's not a prayer, אלא טענה בהכרח כדי לקבל עזרו מקודש. It's not necessarily a prayer that Moshe did, rather he was saying, in order for the name Yud-K to protect you, is because you are humble. If Yoshua would not be humble, then the name of Yud-K would not help him. Now we understand why Moshe Rabbeinu, it says, "V'itpalel Moshe al Yoshua." That's why Moshe prayed for Yoshua. Now we can understand. V'hashtanicha. Now it's comfortable to us to understand. She'itpalel al Yoshua v'lo al Kalev. How come Moshe Rabbeinu prayed on Yoshua, not on Kalev? What is it? Mafia here? You're praying on him and not on him? That doesn't sound nice. But here we understand why Moshe prayed for Yoshua and not Kalev. Why? The Bishlama Yoshua היה מוחזק בו שהיה ענב. Because Moshe Rabbeinu knew with no doubt that Yoshua was humble. He had מידת הענבה. How do we know that? Go to the book of Shmot, chapter 33, verse 11. What does it say? ומשרתו, and the servant of Moshe Rabbeinu, Yoshua בן נון, נער לא ימיש. He was a young man. He would not move away from the tent of Moshe Rabbeinu. He didn't move his sight for one second. What do we learn from that? ובוודאי שהיה מדבק בדרכי רבו. So Yoshua didn't leave for one second Moshe Rabbeinu. Can you imagine being the servant of Moshe Rabbeinu, being the Shamash, the one who's helping Moshe Rabbeinu? So if Moshe Rabbeinu was very humble, he was the most humble of all, and Yoshua was his student, then we'd learn from that. And for sure, Yoshua went in the path of Moshe Rabbeinu, and he was humble too. And it says, how do we know that Moshe Rabbeinu was humble? Then go to the book of Bamidbar, chapter 12, verse 3. Ve'ish Moshe, anav meod. And Moshe Rabbeinu was the most humble person ever existed. So if Moshe Rabbeinu was anav, he was humble, then so much more so, then you learn that his student, his follower, his disciple, his servant, Yeshua, was also humble. אבל בקלב לא היה משה כל כך מוחזק בו. Moshe Rabbeinu, with Kalev, he didn't know if he's humble or not. Moshe Rabbeinu says, Yeshua, that's my student. I know he's humble. I know he has midat ha'anava. Kalev, I'm not so sure. I don't know him so well. ומשום אחי, and therefore, לא התפלל אליו. He didn't pray for him. And we also find, this can be found in the translation that is called Targum Yonatan. Yonatan ben Uziel, he says, ואחד כמה משה ענוותנותה, קרא משה ליהושע בן נון יהושע, Moshe Rabbeinu, because he was humble and he knew that Yoshua is humble, so he called Yoshua bin Nun, Hoshea bin Nun Yehoshua. And then he's sending us to a reference, ve'ayen od mizeh la'il beparashat lech lecha. He's sending us to a reference in Parashat Lech Lecha for the on the verse al pasuk vayet ohalo that Avraham Avinu turned away his tent. He's just giving a reference about the translation of Targum Yonatan. But what do we learn from this part? Moshe Rabbeinu says, listen, Yoshua bin Nun is my servant. I know him. I know that he has midat ha'anava. Kalev, I'm not too sure. So we kind of understand now why Moshe Rabbeinu prayed for Yoshua and not for Kalev. But let me finish the paragraph, then everything will become much more clearer. Now we ask him another question. V'od yesh lomar. בתירוץ קושיית המפרשים, now we have to understand why the commentaries explain למה התפולל משה על יהושע ולא על כלב. Now we really want to understand why did Moshe Rabbeinu prayed for Yoshua and not for כלב. That doesn't sound nice. The קושיה מעיקר עליתה, the difficulty of this question, we can find it right from the beginning. דמי, אולימיה דקלב משאר מרגלים, maybe the power of Kalev was greater than the rest of the spies?
שרי באותה שעה כולם היו כשרים.
In the beginning, when they all went into Eretz Israel, all the meraglim, all the spies were kshirim. They were holy. They were tzaddikim. That's what we know. So Kalev was kind of in the same level of them.
V'im haya mitpalel al Kalev, haya lo litpalel, nami al kulam.
So if Moshe Rabbeinu prayed on them when they walked in, then all of them were in the level of tzaddikim, the heads of Bnei Israel, then Moshe Rabbeinu should have prayed for all of them. Technically, if this is the case,
שהשם יצילה מהחט, that Hashem should save them from a sin,
and worse than that, ממחשבות רעות, from bad thoughts. You know how devastating could be bad thoughts? Look amazingly what he says here. He says that, let's go back a few paragraphs, why did Moshe Rabbeinu pray for Yoshua and not for Kalev? And if Moshe Rabbeinu should have prayed for Kalev, then he should have prayed for all the meraglim. Right? Because Kalev, in the beginning, everybody was in a high level. So if already we're asking, why is Moshe not praying for Kalev? You should ask, why isn't Moshe Rabbeinu praying also for the spies? That would make sense, that Moshe Rabbeinu should pray, that all of them should not sin. But look what he's saying here. We have to see very careful between the words, because when you're reading type of teachings, especially like the Zera Shimshon, you want to see in between the words what he's saying. What is he saying here? היה לו להתפלל נמי, he should have prayed also על כולם, on all of them, שהשם יצילם, that Hashem should save all of them from rot, from the sin, from החט, וממחשבות רעות, or from bad thoughts. Saying here that the severity of a sin is just as bad of bad thoughts. Because where do you come up with all the behavior? From the thoughts. So look what the Zera Shimshon is saying. Moshe Rabbeinu should have prayed for them to save them from two things, sin and bad thoughts. Making now that the bad thoughts are equal to the sin. So we have to learn from that, that it's not only that the action that is devastating, it's also the thoughts are devastating. Sometimes you don't do the sin, but you're thinking what you would want to do, what I wish to do, what I would wish for that person to happen right now. How many times do you see people, they have such hate or jealousy, and what they're thinking about another person, they don't say anything. On the outside they even smile, but the inside is full of hate. So here we have another tip that he says Moshe Rabbeinu could have or should have prayed for all of them to save them from the sin and bad thoughts. But אלא ודאי צריך לומר שתפילה זו לא שייכה. But here we 100% can say the prayer that Moshe Rabbeinu did had nothing to do with praying for Kalev and the spies. Why? משום שכל אדם יש לו בחירה ורצון. You know why Moshe Rabbeinu did not pray for the spies? Technically, that's a very good question. If Moshe Rabbeinu thought or had a vision or felt that they're going to sin, why did Moshe Rabbeinu pray for them? Technically, we should have found Moshe Rabbeinu saying, hey, let me pray for all the spies that they should not sin. But how do we know that Moshe Rabbeinu wasn't even had the idea of praying? He didn't even want to pray. Why? Because every person has bchira. You have a choice to do whatever you want. This is called your own will. And not only that, kol adam yesh lo bchira veratzon. Every person has free will and his own desire. I don't want to pray for you. You have to battle with your own free will. So we see 100% here that the prayer that Moshe Rabbeinu did had nothing to do with saving the spies. Not the 10 spies, not Kalev, not all of them together. From the only reason, because each and every one of us is given free will, one should not pray for another person that his free will should be decided for him. Then what's the free will here? You all have free will. You decide what you do. Just do the right thing. Ve'en achinami she'moshe amityare. And we understand from that Moshe Rabbeinu did not have the fear here. Pen kulam o rubam o miktzatam itapchu l'ra. Moshe Rabbeinu didn't fear. Maybe some of them will sin. All of them will sin. All of them will be good. All of them will go bad. Moshe Rabbeinu didn't even have the fear. He says each and every one of them has their own free will. Let them do whatever they want. Ve'kalev nami, and Kalev also. Let him decide what he needs to do. Afshar shaya kamoem. Kalev was like all of them. Moshe Rabbeinu says, I'm not intervening. You have to deal with your own free will. Uve'enei Moshe, היו אז כולם כשרים. Because when Moshe Rabbeinu sent them, in his eyes, they're all kosher, they're all tzaddikim, they're all righteous.
The lav achi lo ya shulcha mechlal, because if he wouldn't think that, he wouldn't even send them. If Moshe Rabbeinu would not think that the spies are good or kosher, as it says, ksherim, he wouldn't even send them. Because he knew that they're righteous, he sent them. Ela she'af al tzad ha-safek ratza litmoch yad Yoshua betfila. But nevertheless, even though there was a doubt, specifically Yoshua, he wanted to support with a prayer. Why? First of all, the prayer. Nitzachat shemin ha-shamayim lo nichru liyot nisat ba'atzatam. He was worried about Yoshua, that Yoshua will fall into a bad advice and fall in sin. Im yavo leklal etzara, if they will should sin, that he didn't want Yoshua to sin. Hoil shaya anav, why? Because Yoshua was humble and he had midat ha-anava. So now we understand one portion of the commentaries to understand the rest. Now let's we'll finalize this part and now everything will be clear. Od yesh lomar beterutz kushiyot ha-mefarshim. Now we have to add another thing what the commentaries are adding. Delama itpalel Moshe liYoshua velo al ha'acherim. Why did Moshe Rabbeinu pray for Yoshua and not for the others? Forget about Kalev right now. Why did Moshe Rabbeinu take 11 men and put them on one side and Yoshua on the other side? Why Moshe Rabbeinu prays only for Yoshua and not for all the 11 spies? The fact that Kalev didn't sin, that's very nice, and the other 10 sin. But another question that the commentary is asking, why did Moshe Rabbeinu pray only for Yoshua? Shashem yatzila miyetzer hara. Why didn't Moshe Rabbeinu could pray for them? Don't pray for them to change their free will, but pray for the yetzer hara should not be so strong. Maybe pray for their salvation and that they should have power to fight the yetzer hara. Venira masopanim adavar. It looks like Moshe Rabbeinu has favor towards Yoshua. Oh, for Yoshua you're praying, and for all the rest you're not praying? This is called masopanim. Favor, you're not allowed to do such a thing. Imagine a father has 6 kids and he says, I like one of them the most. For him, I'll pray and I'll give him all the candy and the treats and the toys and the rest, I don't care. So that doesn't make, so to say, one can ask, of course, doesn't make Moshe look great. Why are you praying only for Yoshua and not for the rest of the other guys? So we find as follows. Deita besefer Zera Barech. There is a book that is called Zera Barech. And this book was written by a rabbi called Rabbi Brachia Barech Shapira. Shapira, Shapiro. He is the student of Natan Shapiro, Rabbi Natan Shapiro, who is known as the Megale Amukot. I not too long ago gave a story about the Megale Amukot and I gave a little bit of history about the Megale Amukot. Nevertheless, his student, his name is Rabbi Brachia Barech Shapiro. He has a book called Zera Barech. And this is a book that is a kind of a commentary on the Torah, but more on the Kabbalistic approach of the Torah. And he quotes from this book in the name of the Ari HaKadosh. He's quoting, the Ari HaKadosh has, it's not really a book, but it's compiled into a book called Likotei Torah. And in Parashat Shlach, he's quoting something that the Ari HaKadosh wrote there. And he wrote as follows, Sham Katav, Gamken, Shelechach Hitpalel Moshe. Why did Moshe Rabbeinu prayed on Yoshua? She'ata beknisatam la'aretz, now when they went into the land of Israel, Ratza HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Sheyitaber be'elu yudbet nesiim. This is what the Arizal says in Likutei Torah, but the Zera Barech quotes it, and the Zera Shimshon quotes the Zera Barech, that's the book. When the Kadosh Baruch Hu, when the spies went into Eretz Israel, what did the Kadosh Baruch Hu wanted? That the souls of all the tribes should get impregnated into the spies. This is called Ibur. We learned that a few times. Ratza Kadosh Baruch Hu sheyitaber be'elu yudbet nesim. That the souls of the tribes should get impregnated into the bodies of the spies. Nishmot yudbet ha-shvatim. Why? Kedei letaken otam. In order for them to be strong, to be rectified, v'shelo yichteu, and they should not sin. That's a pretty nice gesture from the Kadosh Baruch Hu. He sends the spies. Hashem didn't want to send the spies. But he says, no, you know what? I'll have the souls of the tribes get impregnated in them. If you remember, we learned that a while ago in the Shar Gilgulim, in Gates of Reincarnation, that there are three types of ways how souls come back into this world. Either through a Gilgul, Gilgul is an incarnation, but that means that the soul comes into the body when the person is born and leaves the body when the person dies. This is called a Gilgul. The next way how a soul can come into this world is through what's called Ibu. Ibu is an impregnation, and it can come into the body while the person is alive, stay there for a minute, a month, a year, 10 years, and leave. This is called the Ibu. And the third way is called Yibum. And that is already explained in depth in the Shar Gilgulim. Yibum is when a man dies and he doesn't have kids, so his brother comes to the widow and he has to have a kid with her, and then they bring a soul into the world. It's called Yibum, but Arizal goes in depth in the Gates of Reincarnation about it. You can find it in chapter 5 and 6 and 7 in Gates of Reincarnation. But nevertheless, here the Arizal says, or we should say the other word, the Zera Shimshon is quoting, the Zera Barech who's quoting the Arizal, that says that when the spies went into Eretz Israel, the Kadosh Baruch Hu wanted the souls of the tribes to get impregnated into the spies to assist them. And the Arizal says in the Gates of Reincarnation that why would this happen? To assist the person. And each and every one of us, we don't really feel that, but we get what's called an impregnation. How many times?
Yisachar, the foundation of the tribe.
Yeah.
Yisachar comes to the one of that tribe representing the
100%.
And Goven. Okay.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
So the reason we even us, we can get a visit from a soul of a tzaddik as an impregnation to assist us. And how many times do we are in a time of weakness and we feel suddenly we have a boost? That could be an impregnation. But nevertheless, not to get off the subject, that's what the Arizal is saying. But going back to what we're saying here, the Arizal says, let's quote, go a little bit back, She'ata b'knisatam la'aretz, when they went into the land of Israel, Ratza HaKadosh Baruch Hu she'itaber be'elu yudbet nesim, nishmot yudbet ha'shvatim, the Kadosh Baruch Hu wanted the souls of the tribes, from the actual tribes, Levi, Yisachar, Yehuda, that their souls should be impregnant into the bodies of the spies, to also give them power, to give them koach, to rectify them, that they should not sin. And even if that, when that happened, it didn't help. Omnam, but Levi, the soul of the son of Yaakov, Levi, got impregnated in who? In Yoshua. Omnam Levi nitgelgel be Yoshua. Why? Ki shevet Levi lo shalach meragel. The tribe of Levi didn't send a spy. You know why? Kivan she'en lo chelek ba'aretz. Levi doesn't have a place in the land. He doesn't need a spy. So, but nevertheless, the soul of Levi got impregnated in the body of Yoshua. Ad kan leshono b'kitzur. This is what he quotes, the book of Zera Barech. Now that we see that the soul of Levi was the head of the tribe of who? Shel Moshe Rabbeinu. Levi was the head of the tribe of Moshe. Moshe comes from Levi. Shapiv avad lihiyot makpid alav yoter malacherim. So we understand that Moshe Rabbeinu, it was close to him. It was his tribe. Velika mishum velika masopanim. There's no masopanim here. There's no protection here. There's no seem that Moshe has a favor. Klal at all. Shata udavar nogel atzmo mamash. He just said was very close to him. That was his tribe. Moshe Rabbeinu also. It was part from the tribe of Levi. So we have here to conclude an answer, a few answers. Why did Moshe Rabbeinu did not pray for all the 11 spies? Why did he only pray for Yoshua? First of all, because he was from the same tribe. Moshe Rabbeinu prayed only for Yoshua, but not for all the spies. So first of all, we understand that he didn't want to pray for them in regards to not to change their free will. He says they all have free will. They should decide if they want to sin or not. It's their problem, it's not my problem. If we all get free will, you have to battle your own free will. But here we find here really the message what the Zera Shimshon is trying to say. Why did Moshe Rabbeinu prayed for Yoshua? First of all, we started the class by saying that he added to him the letters Yudke. And we were questioning that. He didn't add Yudke, he only added Yud. Hoshua already had the name, the letter Hey. He didn't add Yud and Hey. He had only Yud. Yehoshua. And his name was Hoshea. But nevertheless, he added the letter Yud-Kei when we mention why. Because the name Yud-Kei cannot dwell on a person that has Geava. And the person who has Geava, that's what we quoted from the Zohar, the 10 men, the spies, had Geava. They did not want to be fired from their position. So therefore, the name Yud-Kei could not dwell on them. Because the name Yud-Kei cannot dwell on a person that has Geava. Yud-Kei is 15, and the word Geava is also 15, the numerical value. So the Kadosh Baruch Hu, Moshe Rabbeinu added the Yud and the K to Yeshua, even though he added the Yud, but he says, no, I'm giving you the Yud and the Hey. Why? So you will be protected. Why did it only work on Yeshua? Because only Yeshua really had Midat Anava. This comes to explain to us, why did Moshe Rabbeinu pray? Moshe Rabbeinu only prayed on Yeshua because only Yeshua had Midat Anava. And this comes to teach us the secret of all. If a person is not humble, prayer will not help. The prayer will only help when the person has Midat Anava. If a person has Midat Geava, the prayer will not work. Moshe Rabbeinu says, I cannot pray for them. As doesn't matter how much I will pray for them, it's not going to work. You know why? Only when a person has Midat Anava, then the prayer will work. And this is really the most powerful thing that we need to understand here. Forget about now, Lashon Hara, not Lashon Hara, the spies sinned, they didn't sin, they said the truth, they didn't say the truth. Leave that to the commentaries. I want to learn from that. Why did Moshe Rabbeinu add to Yeshua Yud-Kei? Because on the surface, he added only a Yud, not a Yud and a Hey. So we explain that very clearly, the Yud and the Hey, because Moshe Rabbeinu says here, I want the name of Hashem to protect you. I want the name of Hashem to bless you. And I want the name of Hashem to take you wherever you go, so you will be saved. And for that he added a prayer, even though he really didn't add a prayer. But nevertheless, what is that prayer? Is to help him, save him in Me'atzat HaMeraglim from the sin. But when we're asking, so why didn't Moshe Rabbeinu pray for all of them? Because they had free will. So why didn't Moshe Rabbeinu didn't pray for Kalev? We see that Kalev didn't sin. So Moshe Rabbeinu says, with Yeshua, I know he's humble. Kalev, I don't know what's the status of his Midat Anava. But what do I want to take from that? Not only that I want to take from that the severity of Lashon Hara and lying and slandering. We talked about that already a few times. I want to take from that the prayer can be only affecting when a person has Midat Anava. The spies, the Zohar says, they had Midat Geava. They didn't want to lose their status. What did the spies say? We are going to go into the land of Israel. And what's going to happen? We are going to be fired from being the Nesim. Moshe Rabbeinu will switch us. They didn't want to lose their status. They had too much Geava. Besides, because they had Geava, then their prayer, even if Moshe Rabbeinu would pray for them, it wouldn't help. It wouldn't dwell on them. Their prayer will not help. So what do I want to take from that? This practically, that in order for a prayer to work, then I have to be humble. If I'm not humble, and if I have Midat Geava, then it will not work. And for that we can understand, when we talk a lot about what's called Tikkun HaMidot, the refinement of character, I've explained that in the same way that Shlomo HaMelech says, Zeh Lumat Zeh Bara Elokim, Kadosh Baruch Hu created everything with an opposition. Now we're going to read about very soon about Bil'am, in a few weeks. Then Bil'am was the Lumat Zeh of Moshe Rabbeinu. Everything has a Lumat Zeh. But nevertheless, even in Tikkun HaMidot, there are some Midot that are good and some Midot that are bad. If you go to the highest of all Midot, on the good side, on the positive side, the highest of all the positive Midot is Midat Anava, the Midah of Anava, of being humble. What's the Le'umat Zeh? What's the same, equal, but in the negative side? Midat Geava, the Midah of pride. Now we're going to start learning about Korach. What triggered Korach? Geava, pride. Now when a person, his pride, his ego is being hurt and pushed, right away it will birth more midot. In this particular case, it will birth anger and sadness. That's how it works. And then will come jealousy and hate and so forth, and that's how it starts. So it's same thing with Korach. Korach had Geava. I should be the one. You know the story with Korach. Korach was the son of Yitzhar. There were four brothers. The father of Moshe Rabbeinu was Amram. He was the oldest brother, the Bechor. Then was another brother, Yitzhar. He was the father of Korach. Then there was a third brother, Hebron. And then the fourth brother was Uziel. Uziel was the father of Elzapan and Mishael. Who's Elzapan and Mishael? These are the cousins of Nadav and Avihu that we spoke about it last week. These were the Kohanim that took out the bodies of Nadav and Avihu when they died. If you remember in the inauguration, Nadav and Avihu dies. They are the son of Aaron. Moshe Rabbeinu calls the cousins, Mishael and Elzapan, and he tells them, you take the bodies out. These are the two individuals that came to Moshe in Parashat Be'alotecha and say, wait a minute, we can't sacrifice on Pesach, we're impure. And therefore they got Pesach Sheni. When it's talking about the people came to Moshe, who's the people who came to Moshe Rabbeinu? Who was impure? Elzapan and Mishael. Why? Because 2 weeks before that, they came and they touched Nadav and Avihu. But Moshe Rabbeinu told them, you take them out. But we're Kohanim, we're priests, we can't touch dead bodies. Nevertheless, take them out. Now, 2 weeks later, comes Pesach and they say to Moshe, we're impure, we touched Kohanim, we touched dead people. Therefore, we got the Pesach Sheni. So, Elzapan and Mishael are the sons of Uziel, the youngest brothers of all. Now, in Parashat Naso, who's the head of the family of Kihat? The family of Kihat is Levi, then Kihat, then from Kihat comes Amram, Itzhar, Hebron and Uziel, the sons of Kihat. Then comes Amram, the father of Moshe. So who became the head of the family of Kihat? Elzapan. Comes Korah and says, whoa, 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 whoa. I should be the one. Why? Because my father is second in line. My father is Itzhar, he's the second. I should be the head. You're giving to the youngest? That's where Korach gets upset. That's where it all starts. I should be the one. So it starts with jealousy and ego, and from that it turned into hate, Lashon Hara, and look what happened to Korach. So what are we concluding from all this? One thing, be humble. Midat ha'anava. And here we learn from that the prayer, when you want the prayer to help, you want the prayer to affect, it has to be midat ha'anava. Can be geava. The second that there's geava, there's pride, nothing will work. I told you once a famous story that happened here in Tzfat. The Arizal had a few students. One of them was giving over a Dvar Torah. It was so amazing, so brilliant, so unbelievable that suddenly as he's talking, they all look at their Rebbe, the Ari HaKadosh, and suddenly his face goes like that. And then a few moments later, he goes again like that. A few moments later, he goes again like that. They don't understand. And then after a while, suddenly his face becomes shocked and sad, and that's it. They come later on and tell him, what happened? So he says, while this individual, the student, was giving over this Dvar Torah, it was so amazing, then suddenly the soul of Avraham Avinu walks into the room. Ooh, the Arizal was like shocked. Moments later, the soul of Yitzchak. Moments later, the soul of Yaakov. He starts seeing, they're all coming in. Moshe Rabbeinu, Aaron, David HaMelech. The Arizal was shocked, he sees them all. So they say, so why at some point you got so upset? He says, because they all just got up and leave. So the question is, why did they get up and leave? So the Arizal said to the student, because in the beginning you were giving this Torah, you were so into it, you were so inspired, but for one moment you had a little bit of geava, a little bit of pride that, look what I taught, look what I brought down. And the second, there was a little bit of pride, a little bit of ego, they all left. So we know that the Kadosh Baruch Hu says, "En shorei HaKadosh Baruch Hu," the Kadosh Baruch Hu cannot dwell in a place that is geava. That's it. So this is where we learn another important thing about this whole encounter is that one needs to be humble. And yes, the Yetzer Hara is going to constantly attack us. We're constantly going to be triggered and questioned and tested. And nobody can intervene because that's where we have free will. Kadosh Baruch Hu says, I'm not going to intervene. You have free will. You choose the right thing. But nevertheless, we see that we pray for everything. Every day we pray. People are sick, we pray. People need parnasah, we pray. You want the prayer to work? You have to be humble. Person has midata geava. Person has pride. What did the Zohar say? What did we quote from the Zohar? That the spies, they went into Eretz Israel. What did they say? We are now the heads of the tribes. If we're going to go into Eretz Israel, the status will change. We will be fired. Moshe Rabbeinu will appoint new leaders. Now we're going to lose our status. We don't want to lose our status. This is geava. Okay, so let's manipulate here. This is what geava does. This is what pride does. And I think the message is very clear that one should be more humble and work on their midata anava in every situation than instead of having geava, Everything comes from the Kadosh Baruch Hu. Kadosh Baruch Hu is the one who chooses who will be the leader, who will be the boss, who will be the successful one, who's going to be the one who leads, who's going to be anything. I have to be humble that whatever the Kadosh Baruch Hu decides, that's what's going to happen. Now we're going to learn about Korach. We're going to learn now not only about Korach, about the real troublemakers. People think that Korach was the troublemaker. Korach was just a jealous individual. There are another two troublemakers, Datan and Aviram. These were the problem. These two were the problem, not Korach. Korach just had an agenda. He just wanted to be a leader. The troublemakers were Datan and Aviram. That we'll keep it ready for the next class. But the point we want to take from that is something very simple. You want Yudkei to dwell on you, the name of Hashem to dwell on you, is only when a person has Midata Anava. All the revelations that all the prophets ever got, all the revelations that great Tzaddikim ever got, everything that was always achieved in the best way possible was only because Midata Anava, the Midah of Anava. Look at Moshe Rabbeinu. There was never a prophet like Moshe. Lo kam kenavi kemoshe. Moshe Rabbeinu spoke to Hashem face to face. All the prophets got their prophecy while they were sleeping. Why? Moshe Rabbeinu had Midata Anava. So this is where we see the saturation, the contrast between Geava and Anava. And any person that has a Geava, what's called the Baal Geava, that's the recipe for destruction, the recipe of all disasters. And needless to say that the key of everything, prayer doesn't work. The key of prayer will not work when you have Geava.